The next speaker, Dr. Shitanshu Mishra, who is the Information Technology Officer working with UNESCO MGIEP. The topic of the presentation is Multimodal Learning Analytics in Technology Enhanced Education. Dr. Shitanshu Mishra is a learning and educational technology scientist with over 9 years of experience. He completed his PhD at the Educational Technology Department in IIT Bombay, Mumbai. And his research areas include AI in education, multimodal learning analytics, modeling cognitive and metacognitive strategies, effective computing and technology enhanced learning, technology enhanced learning of disciplinary practices. So may I request Dr. Shitanshu Mishra to please present. Over to you, Dr. Shitanshu.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. My screen is visible and my audio is audible.
Yeah, both are.
Both are okay. Audible and visible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah. So hi, my name is Shitanshu and I'm a information technology officer working with MGIEP UNESCO. So it's the Mahatma Gandhi Institute for education for peace and sustainable development. That's MGIEP, and it's a educational research institute of UNESCO, happened to be stationed in New Delhi. And yeah, so I'm going to talk a bit about multimodal learning analytics. Mostly it will cater to those who are interested in doing learning analytics, multimodal learning analytics. And I'll be talking about some fundamental know-hows of if we want to start doing multimodal learning analytics, what should we be prepared with? So this is a brief snapshot of what Mr. Kumar just introduced about me. So currently I am with UNESCO, and before that I worked with IIT Bombay and Vanderbilt University as postdoc, and before that I completed my PhD in educational technology at Bombay. So let's start with the most frequent term that we have been listening to since morning is technology enhanced education. So one speaker rightly said that it's enhanced and it's not enabled. Enhanced is the more appropriate word. So let's see what is technology enhanced education and what it has led to. I mean, we all know what is technology enhanced education. So what it has led to for years, I mean, for decades, in fact, I mean, the form of technology has improved, but technology existed for decades, right? So technology enhanced education led to improvement of effectiveness. So it could be effectiveness of learning or effectiveness of the system or the lesson plan or whatever objective we intend to achieve. It is achieved more effectively by our technology enhanced education. Other thing that technology enhanced education led to is increase in efficiency. So for efficiency could be, for example, previously I could teach only a batch of 40 students in a class, and maybe some technology might have helped me in scaling this up and conducting class of 200 students. So this is one of the efficiencies. Efficiency could be in terms of number of students, in terms of time, all those things. Other important thing is attractiveness, and attractiveness relates to different aspects of learner. For example, if learner is enjoying the system or not, if a learner is willing to start doing some activity on a learning environment or not. Or learning environment could be a computer-based learning environment or a blended or just face-to-face learning environment. But in all of these environments, technology enhanced education take place. And the fourth one is improvement of accessibility, as my last speaker talked about increasing accessibility for especially abled learners. It also refers to improvement in accessibility with respect to the digital penetration, with respect to distance from where the teacher, where the teaching learning content, and where the learner, all those things. So these are the four important aspects from technology enhanced learning matrix, which are effectiveness, efficiency, attractiveness, and accessibility. And technology enhanced learning lead to improvement in those areas. Now, a specific branch, a subset of technology enhanced education is where technology is related to artificial intelligence, right? Now, what AI may lead to, in a nutshell, we can say that AI may lead to, traditionally, we talk about inclusive access, but with AI, it's not just inclusive, but it increments to enabling personalized treatment. So not just including everyone, but actually including everyone to the level that we can create personalized feedback, personalized scaffolds in the learning environment. Other aspect that AI enhanced education enables us right now is, before we used to talk about low skill teaching. Okay, achieve. So for example, the different Bloom's level we are trying to achieve now, in addition to thinking about the skill achievement, we also now able to think about innovative pedagogies and innovative pedagogies in terms of technology enhanced learning. Next is content profiling. So previously we used to think about, okay, this content is fitting this objective, and this content doesn't fit this objective, how much it fits, how much it doesn't. Now AI can enable us to go slightly beyond just thinking about if content is better for the learning or not. We also can now think about, given whatever the content is, what are the learning problems for our learners? Okay, so AI is enabling us to track the learning problems. That's a different level of possibilities with AI enhanced education. And then fourth one is, instead of just grading, we now can talk about actually materializing and making outcomes possible, right? So for outcomes, maybe, for example, not just learning, but reducing the dropout rates or increasing the engagement with the course content. So these are some these are some objectives which we could not think of directly before, but now with the advent of AI, we can now start thinking of, we have already started achieving a lot of these objectives. And so what is multimodal learning analytics? A set of multimodal sensory inputs that can be used to predict, understand, and quantify student learning. Right, so these are two things which are important in this definition. One is multimodal sensory inputs. So someone is using multiple sensory inputs. Other is, it is talking about student learning. So the question is, why should we use multimodal, more than one sensors from more than one modalities? And second question is, which is more important, it's more important, it's more basic, is what is learning and who is our learner? So before, without understanding these two, we may not be able to start with a multimodal learning analytics and design and engineering based on that. So who is a learner? Let's see. So a learner is typical an human being. Most of the time we are training human being, right? So not training, but making them learn, right? So a learner is typically a human being, and therefore a human being should have emotions. A human being should perform cognition, some thinking. A human being also interacts with his or her environment, and a human being also interacts with the society. So This means that human is a social element, a social entity. Human being is a emotional entity, is a cognitive entity. Human being also interacts with the environment. And ultimately, human being also demonstrates behavior. So this behavior is something which is important, because most of the time we have been relying our studies and research on observing the behavior, because it is only behavior that we can observe, right? Most of the time. So, but and all other things, even cognition and even emotions, we try to infer based on what behavior we observe. So this we are going to talk about later, but summarizing this is that we need to be cognizant of the fact that our learners are human being, and all the aspects of a human being should be affecting how they are learning, if they are learning, if they have learned successfully or not, what could be the reasons of learning success or learning failure. So can we afford to ignore any of these aspects when designing lesson plans or learning environments? I think no, right? So as a human teacher, we may not. So as most of the time are many experienced teachers who are teaching face to face, they can themselves handle a lot of aspects. They can look at the behavior of their students. They can infer the emotions. If their students are now getting bored, let's switch the gear to something else and change the lecture accordingly. So human teachers can, up to some extent, I mean, experienced teachers do it very effectively. They gauge the emotions, they can understand if cognition is happening or not. But what about machines? If we want to do some computer-based learning or technology-enhanced learning, right? So, for example, MOOCs or intelligent tutoring system. Now, how to make sure that we don't ignore these aspects. So not ignoring any of the human aspects, this is a challenge, right? And the specific challenges are, how can we enable machines to track different human aspects, and how can we enable machines to track even a single aspect accurately? So if I say that I'm tracking how a student is solving a problem, am I tracking it fully, or I'm just tracking some level of abstracted behavior, right? So how third challenge is how to increase the perception power of machines. Okay, so the solution is leverage the availability of multiple sensors and data sources. So let's look at this challenge with an example of one of my project during my postdoc at Vanderbilt University. So the project is about a learning environment. Its name is Betty's Brain. So this is just for example. So the name of the system is Betty's Brain, and the student performs some activities on this system to learn climate change topic. A science topic, right? So what activities learner does? Learner reads some content. Learner also performs some quiz activities. Learner create some causal map, concept map kind of maps. And then learner also performs map building activity, analyzes the map, and then follows some instructions and hints given by different agents. So now different levels of activities learner does. Now, if we want to understand that what learner is doing, how learner is solving the problem, creating the map, analyzing the map, when learner is reading or something, reading or not reading, one thing that we could do is we could track learner's click streams, where learner is clicking, which tab learner is clicking on this screen, right? That's one thing we can do, okay? Now, if learner, so this means that if the moment learner clicks anything on the screen, I can track that behavior. Now I want to increase the perception power of my machine. How to do that? I have to track more behavior. So before that, let's think of what more behavior I can't track right now. So just depending on click stream, I can track those events when there is a click. But what about learner has opened a page, and suppose learner is reading this block, and runner is then reading this block, and then learner is reading this block without any movement of the mouse cursor. So we can't track that. So for that, we need to again depend on some more fine-grained data collection. So what I did in this project, I depended on eye tracking. So eye tracking was used to study that where a student learner is looking at, and for how much time the person is looking at anything, right? So this information further gave me a more in-depth perception of how learning is happening, right? So previously I could only use mouse clicks, but between two mouse clicks I used to miss the data. But now after using eye tracking, I am now able to track things in between the clicks also. So that increases my perception power. So how to increase perception power? Multimodal is the answer to that. So in order to answer any research question, we need some data. The deeper the data is, more fine-grained data is, the more accurate, not accurate, but more, I mean, accuracy could have different abstract level, but more in-depth, more complete our solutions would be, more complete our knowledge discovery would be. So modes of learning, teaching, we see that there are online learning, offline learning, blended learning. Now data is available in all these modes. However, online and blended give us better opportunities to collect diverse data. So availability is one thing, being able to collect is another thing. So that's the a good thing about modern times, that now we can also collect data. So in a face-to-face lecture, in an offline face-to-face lecture, what we can, we have a lot of students, data is there, but it's very hard to collect data and collect how they are interacting with the teachers, lectures, and the problem solving, etc. But if a student is doing everything online, for example, then we can track each and every, I mean, almost all learner inputs, including click stream. And if you use eye tracking, including that, if you use camera, then you can start tracking learner's face video, and through which you can further generate emotions. So that is what modern day online learning has afforded. So not just increasing the accessibility, but it has also enabled us to track learners better as compared to non-offline modalities. So where do we collect data from? So online, offline could be a formal setting, which is a ecological setting, but laboratory settings are something which we create for analysis, for research, right? So let's see what these learning analytics researchers have been doing. So this, I will share you three data from a paper that was published in 2018 by Mosler-Worsley, and it has 5 years of literature review on the different papers submitted in a learning analytics community. So where they have been collecting data from, all those papers, they have been mostly collecting data from laboratory settings, because they have very specific questions, and having a control study, a deterministic study, is more feasible in a laboratory settings. And 13 out of total 48 papers, they collected data from ecological settings such as classrooms or from synchronous online settings. So from the same paper, there's other data which is about what different modalities, different sensors that researchers have been collecting data from. So we can see that their top five modalities were audio, video, biophysics data, or eye trackers and digital log. So audio, video data, we understand biophysics data are from collecting data like EEG signals, or collecting data like skin conductance and so on. Eye trackers we know, and digital log is it's like for those who are developing technology in enhanced learning environment, they understand that when they are creating a learning environment, computer based learning environment, they also create a background logging modules which logs user clicks, user actions. So they are known as digital log, right? And other important thing is, okay, they are collecting data, they are collecting data from different sensors. What they are collecting data for? So they are collecting data for studying educational or learning constructs like learning, multimodal behavior, collaboration, expertise, effect, attention, success, so on so forth. So most of us, we do learning, right? We mostly do learning, study learning. But there are a lot of different constructs in learning and education that we need to study if we want to understand our students completely, or if we want to actually create effective solutions. Okay, so what we do with this data? With data, we collect data, we assess data, and we generate some feedback for the learners, feedback or scaffold for the learners to improve the learning, right? So now this can be implemented either for real-time requirements or asynchronous requirements. For example, asynchronously, I collected data, I analyzed the data and analysis results. After doing multimodal learning analytics, I generated some inference, and from those inference, I created scaffolds. And then I implemented those scaffolds in my system again. Okay. So that's asynchronous. But in real time, what is needed is, you in real time, you collect the data. In real time, system will process the data, analyze the data, and create a feedback, generate a feedback accordingly. Select the feedback or generate the feedback accordingly, right? So if we collect data, how to decide what all data to collect, what should be analyzed, and how to, and if we are converting data into some inferences, then how to infer the data, right? And similar, and again, third important thing is how to design feedback if we are designing feedback accordingly. So if I'm addressing to a computer scientist popular audience, that if we know learning analytics and data science, all those things, I mean data analytics and data science, can we do all these things on our own? So what is needed to do all these things is learning science theory. So this is really important. So what we often forget to do is, like, we start collecting data, start doing some machine learning processes or data analytics processes, but we don't take learning science theory in center. So that is one thing that we often tend to miss. And many of us miss, but this we cannot afford to miss, right? So can you imagine doing bioinformatics without theoretical knowledge of life sciences? I guess no, right? You can't do bioinformatics. So it's like bioinformatics, this is learning informatics, right? So similarly, for learning science and education people, as a learning science researcher, designers, or engineers, we need to work with obviously with ML, AI, and data science domain that many of us are equipped with, also cognitive science, and also learning science. This needs to be taken care of, and this is what I'm advocating right now, that as a computer scientist and data scientist, we also need to take care of cognitive science and learning science, and to do that, we can collaborate with people in those domains. We can enhance our own knowledge. That we can do, right? Okay, how much time I have?
5 minutes more.
Okay, the great. So in 5 minutes, let me show you an example of one multi-modal learning analytics project that I did. I mean, apart in addition to the Betty's win that I just shown. So these are some different projects that I did, and so this one is about effective cognitive computing. Here we work with emotions, and we try to map emotions, emotion features with the eye tracking features. So this is done because this was done because we wanted eye tracker is not available everywhere. So we wanted to map computer vision features with eye tracking features. So similar kind of, I mean, there are other projects also, but what I'm going to talk about is SAMT. SAMT is a augmented reality environment, in fact, not just a one small computer. It's the whole room environment where there is in a room like space on the three walls of the room. We have big screens, and these screens, they run simulations of different battle drills. Not different battle drills, but a specific battle drill which is related to enter and clear room. So suppose a building is infested with terrorists, and we need to train our soldiers to how to do this enter and clear room operation. They have to enter the room, kick the door. Within 5 seconds, they have to identify who are the terrorists, who are not terrorists, and they have to neutralize the needed people, those who are terrorists, and they have to save who are not the terrorists. So they have to perform within 5 seconds. They have to do a lot of mental processes, decision making, quick decision making, as well as they have to hold their gun and perform all the actions. So that requires a lot of psychomotor skills. So this was for US Army, and the objective of the project was to improve these different skills. So psychomotor skills, cognitive strategies, and team skills also. This is an other level of skills. So this slide shows what they do in enter and clear room. They a team of four, they call them fire team. They enter the room, and then there is a protocol which person will go in which direction at what time, and then how to cover the whole room. So this is typical. This typically completes in 5 seconds, and sometimes maybe less than 5 seconds, right? So these skills are needed to be inculcated if you want to train our learners, I mean the army trainees, in enter and clear room related skills, right? So what data we collected? We collected action logs, which is digital logs from the system. So their gun had sensors. They had head-mounted eye trackers on them. Then there were cameras to infer postures. So and there we collected audio data, then bioharness data to see if they are how they are breathing and how that relates to their emotions and all. I mean whether they are anxious or whether they are relaxed, all those things. So we collect all these data, and then what we plan to just use the data to infer different, to compute different levels of skills that our learners have acquired. Okay, so just to show you one glimpse of how we do different measures. So on the rightmost column is data sources. So we collect video observation, and video observation typically led with using some computation, it led to the performance in team skill coordination. Similarly, eye tracker data we use to compute some cognitive processing. Similarly, video observation was again used for psychomotor skills monitoring and performance measurement. Okay, so there were other data sets also, and similarly these data sets are converted to different types of skills. So whatever we observe, so the lowest layer is what we can observe. And then using what we sense, what we observe, we infer the different sub skills and bigger skills which are needed for battle drill. And then we use those observations and sensor values to compute the skill levels. So that was the project, Enter in Clearroom. So quickly, what I am doing, what MGIP does, right, does where I am situated right now. So MGIP has a vision UN Sustainable Development Goal is there, and towards that goal, we are creating educational solutions to make this world a peaceful and sustainable place to live in, right? So in one line, the objective is to transform education for humanity by building social emotional learning for education. So here we acknowledge that a human learner and everyone is social and emotional entity, and if we want to make them learn anything, we need to take care of social emotional aspects. Yeah, so what we do is we do research and training on social emotional learning and on digital pedagogies. We do research and training on and digital pedagogies. It's repeated, okay. Part of research, it's not repeated, but yeah, it's research and training on SEL as well as research and training using SEL. So we also train people on climate change and other important courses, which are not there normally in traditional curriculums. So training on SEL and training using SEL that we do. And other big aspect is we do research on policy and we advocate policy. And most of the time, mostly we do training online. And my role is to work, develop that platform, which is known as Framerspace.com. And this platform hosts all the courses. And here, what we are trying to do is collect, with respect to multimodal learning analytics, collecting different user digital logs and their text. So using NLP, using their learning choices, learning logs, we try to infer social, infer different aspects of empathy, compassion, critical inquiry, and so on. So all those aspects are related to social emotional learning, and then we study how those aspects actually lead to effective learning of what we want them to learn. So audiences are teachers, students, youth, and stakeholders such as principals, and in company, in industries also stakeholders, and then decision makers. Yeah, so this is what we do. Right, thank you, and I would be happy to collaborate. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shitanshu. Thank you for sharing your experiences in implementing multimodal learning analytics, and also sharing some of the challenges in collecting the data for learning analytics.